everyone. Welcome to our workshop on cyber-physical systems. So the sheet that you got in your hand contains different things. We will also show in the slides. So on the left, we have our agenda for today. Then we have what you answered to the question what cyber-physical systems are. And then we have a definition of cyber-physical systems. So this sheet is basically a take-home so that you have something in your hand. We will also cover it in the slides. I would like to start our workshop with a video. And before I do that, we want to record the session. So this is where I put this small camera there. And here's a sheet where you can sign that you're okay with that the session is recorded. If you do not want to be recorded, you can just sit in this edge there. Then you're definitely not on the video. But in the end, you
and
will
don't
be
say, and don't say anything.
Well, we can be present with audio, right?
Yeah. So I hope it's okay for everyone. Anyone have objections? Okay, so probably we'll offer you the video afterwards so you can have a look at it again. Pardon?
The question is what you do with the video afterwards.
I want to provide it to you so that you can have a look at the session again. So this is the major purpose. Okay, so here's the list so you can just sign. I hope someone has a pen because I need mine. Okay, so as I told you, we'll start with a short video, and the video shows how every aspect in our life are more and more depending on cyber-physical systems.
Something as simple and innocuous as this becomes a challenge for all of us to maintain accountability control of our critical infrastructure systems. This actually contains the Stuxnet virus. It's impacting industrial control. If you get up in the morning and turn off your alarm and make coffee,
power plants, power grids,
and pump gas,
transportation, telecommunication,
and use the ATM, you've touched industrial control systems. It's what powers our lives.
Okay, so we get some idea. So welcome to the workshop. I'm honored and very happy to welcome Joseph Sifakis. Without him, the workshop would not have happened because he was proposing this topic and he was greatly assisting us to bring the workshop. And his friend, Vinton Cerf, you probably also know him, he agreed to giving also a talk in this workshop, which is a great thing, so we're really happy about that. And I'm happy to welcome my co-organizers, Amel Bennaceur and Sai Manoj. And my name is Marc-Oliver Pahl. Okay, so the agenda for today is I will continue with the introduction. Then we will have three research examples where we show, okay, how are cyber-physical systems linked to the research that us three are doing. Then Wien will give a talk about cyber-physical systems and the Internet of Things. Afterwards, Joseph will tell something about linking physicality and computation. Then we will have a practical example of a cyber-physical system, which is an infusion pump, so that you get an idea, kind of a hands-on, because we are limited in time, so we cannot really do a hands-on, but we want to provide you some experience so that you have an idea. And then we have a bigger part where we want to discuss with you. So this workshop is a great opportunity in a smaller group to discuss with the experts here about cyber-physical systems, which is a really big thing that is currently happening, as also the video should motivate. And finally, we do a short wrap-up, and then we're through. Okay, so to continue with the introduction. I sent you before the workshop a link to this feedback sheet in Google Docs, and 17 of you filled it out, so thanks a lot for doing so. And the input you gave was really great because it totally matched our expectations. So you did very well in filling it out, so you're perfectly right in this workshop. And one thing I asked you to answer is what is also on the sheet I handed out. What is a cyber-physical system? And here we see the frequency of words that occur, and I just put three fat. So we have environment, networking, and software. All the others also fit to the definition, and this is also close to the first definition that I want to give you today. What is a cyber-physical system? So a cyber-physical system integrates computation, physical processes, and networking. It is complex because when you think about such a system, the physicality, so the things surrounding us, are typically continuous. But when it comes to software is discrete. So this is challenging then, mixing the two. Discrete, especially in time, so you have to do something called sampling, and also in values, so you have to do quantization. Software is more difficult to verify than hardware in general, and when you mix it with the physicality, it gets even harder. Cyber-physical systems bring opportunities because you have more flexibility, you have better cost efficiency, but they also bring risks because you have attacks, as we've seen in the video, and you also can have unwanted behavior. Okay, so let's get to the three research examples. So Sai will start, Amel will continue, and I will do this with perspective.
Hi. That's a brief introduction to me. So I'm Sai from TU Wien. So I'm working on this cyber-physical system on chip design, especially targeting this health applications. So this is just a brief introduction about me, like where I did my bachelor's, master's, and PhD, and now currently I'm located in TU Wien as a postdoc there. So this is just provides an overview of my research, like what I'm doing now. So like I started with something like a multi-core processor designs, and then went to the resource management, especially the power management, bandwidth management, and so on, and then looked into some emerging technologies like 2D and 3D integrations and so on. So then now I'm currently working on this, how could we make this hardware for this kind of healthcare applications and for CPSOCs. So that's how this kind of the definition of the CPSOC came up with. Like, we share the whole cyber-physical system on one single chip, so we don't know how far we will progress yet. It's just there. So, and one more thing we are investigating is that self-aware cyber-physical system. So how could we make the system to be self-aware itself, not just of the environment, but also of itself. So this is just an example showing that one of the examples that we are working on, like this is a biopatch modeling and prediction patch. So let's assume that I have a sensor attach it to my body. So like let's say that it has different sensors. I'm using like temperature sensor, voltage sensor, humidity and sound sensor and many other sensors. So we have a lot of data that will be collected by these sensors. So first problem to focus is that what data is necessary for the system to process and what is not. Because I can't take huge amounts of data in continuous manner. So first is that how could I filter that? Next part that comes up is that kind of attach it to body. This is just an example, but this shows this kind of awareness. So the system should know its state, like is it attach it to the body or not. I mean, I can't use the system by just keeping on and turning it on, and it's kind of do something useless. And then how could I improve it, the functioning of that, and make it more stable and robust? And then how could I evaluate my decisions? You know, it's not so simple that I say, okay, this is something, and so I give it this way. So it has to be more robust and has different kinds of outputs that different users like to see. So and how could I model all these kind of changes, because it just does not involve the sensors, but also it has some inputs from outside, noises and the abstraction of data and many other factors that include here. So this is one example. And then the CPSOC for the healthcare, this is one example also. So here we show that, assume that a person is attached with a sensor or some kind of a chip, which is kind of used for this body monitoring or health monitoring. So it has to take different types of things, like let's say that his altitude, position, heart rate, and his temperature, and his oxygen levels, and many other things into consideration. And then it has to perform the data abstraction, that's to kind of reduce it. And then it has to kind of do some kind of classifications, categorizations, and also some kind of modeling of the whole system of the person. So this all kinds of things involve a lot of complexities and a lot of mathematics as well. And then the system also has to understand what it is intended for, which is missing in many of the systems. Like we kind of put it for specific purpose, but the system doesn't know what its goal is actually. It's already pre-functioned or pre-programmed and it just does what it needs. Something like what its goal is, and it has to assess itself and it has to work based on its goals, not based on the user provided or the designer provided. So these are some of the things that I'm currently working on, and then I'll relate some more things in this workshop. So Amel, you can see it, have a few
questions. Thanks. So thanks,
Just a second.
Okay, I can continue. Sorry about that. So I'm Amel Bennaceur. I'm recently appointed lecturer at the Open University in the UK, and my research is about creating software that make other software components talk to each other, so that we can support individuals in their achieving their goals. So that's the big picture. And we do it through mediator synthesis, and I will tell you what mediator synthesis is. And I was mainly applying it in two domains, interoperability, to make components talk to each other, and security, so in using smart homes. And it takes, actually it influences from three domains: adaptive software, because basically this software are deployed in the environment and the environment can change, so we need to adapt to these changes. In distributed system, because the components actually are distributed across many devices, across servers, and they need to communicate over the network. And the third, formal methods, because we want to guarantee that the software we are creating will do what we expect it to do, so we will achieve finally the goals. So what is mediator synthesis? And it basically goes in three main roles of this mediator. So when we have two components that are independently developed, they may have different interfaces and different behaviors. And to make them communicate, we have to compensate for these differences. So the mediator has to do three things. The first one is translation. So if one component calls something A and the other calls it B, we need something to translate it. And here we use maybe ontologies to do this translation. The second one is controller synthesis. So we need to coordinate the behavior of the component to reach a state where the goal is achieved. So you do first A, and then I do B, and then we do C. So we coordinate to reach our final goal. And the third one is middleware synthesis, which is basically we have an abstract model that we need to execute it. So by the end, we start from the software, we do our models, we reason about them, we have our guarantee, but then we turn back into software. So the middleware of actually we include back the protocol, the messages, the data format, so that we can execute what we just synthesized. So what does this mean in practice? So this means that you can use, one of you can use Yahoo Messenger, and the other use XMPP, which is a standard used by Gmail, for example. And you can exchange messages because we generate this mediator, this intermediary software. It means that you also can use Finder, which supports WebDAV, another standard for file exchange to access your Google Drive. And in a more general case, you can also use it in emergency management. So here, for example, we have a command and control center that has been developed to deal with an unmanned ground vehicle, and we can use it to control drones. And this last example is of particular interest, because once you start doing manipulating drones, it's not only about the interfaces and the behavior, but there are other phenomena that happens that relate to the physical world that you have to take care of. So for example, if you are flying the drones, then you have to take care of the speed, the wind, the speed at which it takes off, etc. Which leads me actually, this is my past research, which was basically composing services into composing things. And these things can be cyber, so the software, it can be objects that sometimes that we can manipulate, and it can be social, so people. So, and especially now, that's why I'm interested in also this cyber-physical system, is this two composition of these two main components, the software and the objects. So, and one idea is like the mediator basically knows how to have the environment represented using a discrete time automaton. You have also a property, but this is what we call the goal, which is often using some parallel logic. So the semantics are also in automata. And then we know how to, well, to some extent, know how to synthesize the other software such that the two protein pile will satisfy this property. There are also a lot of theory on dynamic controllers that are also very good with dealing with the physical phenomena and that can adapt the system. So the main, my main interest, or the going, the next steps, let's say, is how these two, to understand how these two can be put together and how these two interact. So that's it.
Okay, great. So you will also get the slides afterwards, and this is why we also put slides in where we will not tell much about. So this is just my starting slide. These are my two research interests. The one is teaching. The one more interesting for this workshop is about on this what I call distributed smart space orchestration. What does it mean? It means all of us have a smartphone, or most of you have it. And what you can do there is you can just install new software, so something from the cyber. Yes, please.
Could I interrupt and suggest if you stand next to the lectern, then you won't block the slide. Thank
okay.
you.
So you can see that. Thanks for the tip. Okay. So, it's about on smartphones, you can install software. And the software changes the behavior of the smartphone. And so my research is about how can you do that for real physical spaces, like this room. So how can you install software in smart spaces? And what is a smart space? So a smart space is a physical space that contains cyber-physical systems. So systems that interact between the software and the physicality. And also forms a cyber-physical system because it manages all the different devices and the common functionality on them. Some challenges I look at are listed here. A technology or some tooling that one can use to progress with the research there is modeling, and we'll have a look at modeling right now. And so here we see a system as I typically use it. And what is most interesting to us here is the process on the left, which is how do I get from a physical phenomenon, namely a temperature, to then a discrete value that is minus 10 degrees here. So we'll have a look at, we have this physical phenomenon, then we have a sensor, then we have a software process, and this software process somehow finds out, okay, what was measured by this system here is minus 10 degrees here. And so I also brought the sensor, so this is this small sensor here, I can give it around. And this one is a system, so this could be a cyber-physical system because you have an Arduino and you connect those sensors and then you can sense with the sensor the real temperature. So maybe I move this one around so you can see it. Maybe you didn't have it in your head before. Okay, so how do we get there? So what we see is, so this is again the same thing, so this is the yellow software component. And we have this sensor that I'm just giving around. And then we have a model of the physical phenomena that it's measuring, because it's changing its resistance based on the temperature that it senses. And so we have this model inside the software. We can simplify it to a lookup table, from the model to the lookup table here. And in this table, we have different temperatures with a granularity of 10 degrees each. And so, for simplicity reasons, I just modeled the range between minus 20 and 0 degrees here. So we are mostly interested in this area right now. And what we want to have after the process is that we end up with the knowledge, so that we end up with, we have minus 10 degrees right now. We can model the entire thing as an automaton that you see here, so a finite state machine. So we have a starting state, and now we have those edges here. And on this edge it says, okay, the resistance is currently below 733 ohms. If so, we assume it's minus 20. Okay, so let's assume this is the case right now. Then we're in the state minus 20. Now the resistance is rising, and here it says if it's above 733 ohms, then we take this transition here. So we go to minus 10, it continues rising, it goes above 802. We take the transition, we end up at 0 degrees. And if it falls, then we go back again. What's interesting here is that the transition on the upper side is at 802 and the transition on the lower side is at 761. And so this one is then called hysteresis because you have some area in between. And this is done because otherwise the system could flip very often here because it could be that you measure 802 ohms and in the next second 801 again. And then it would go back and forth here and this would produce a lot of computational effort on the processor running this program here. What you can do is you can model this one inside a tool. So we'll see this tool later again. So here I model the electrical component. So basically here we have the resistance. It's going up and down. And on the right side we have the system we were just looking at. And so we see that when we get it running now, that it starts on the left and then it's quickly moving to the right. And here we see the temperature, so it's not well readable. So in the online slides you will have the link, and there I also explain how I built this system. So you can have a look at it after the workshop offline. Okay, good. Then we come to the next part.
Thank you, Mark. So I'll try to make this quick. And I'll try to get out of the way of my own slides here. First of all, I want to make sure that we have a common sense of what cyber-physical systems are. Most people speak about robots, things that are mechanical, that can affect the real world by picking things up and moving them around, cars that are driving on their own. But I think we should expand our notion of robotics to include things like fast trading systems on the stock market. And the reason I think this is that they take real-world information, they process it, and then they have a real-world impact on your bank account. And I consider that to be just as real as picking up a glass and putting it in the deep. I think any programmable device, like a massage chair, can certainly qualify as a cyber-physical system. I don't sit in the massage chairs at Google because I know they're driven by software, and I'm afraid that one of them is going to go like that while I'm inside, so I don't sit in them. I'm worried about bugs. JavaScript, Java, Python, and other web languages also process information. They show up on web pages, but the inputs that they could get might come from the physical world, and the outputs might also have an impact. So all of this, this space is, I think, part of the general dialogue of cyber-physical systems. I also think most of the problem that we're going to have with cyber-physical systems is with the software. Mostly because software has bugs, and unless Leslie Lamport figures out a way for us to write software that has fewer bugs, we're going to be faced with this problem. And there are all kinds of issues, one of which is fixing the bugs. And the question is, for cyber-physical systems that are distributed throughout a building, that we carry on our persons, that are in the car, and so on, we have to find ways of updating them in order to fix the bugs that have been discovered. But now there's a question about, where did the update come from? Is this from the right source? Is it from some hacker? Is it malware that you're about to ingest into this system? Now, what about the mechanism by which the update happens? What about the longevity of these devices? Some of them may last for 10, 20, or 30 years because you bought it to be part of the house, heating, ventilation, and air conditioning system. So that means that we're likely to have old software and old processors that live for a long time and still need to be upgraded from time to time. I'm very concerned that the devices that are part of these systems know with whom they are communicating. I don't want my devices to give information to some unauthorized party, and I certainly don't want them to accept control from a party I didn't authorize, which means I have to have a strong ability for the device to know what it's talking to and whether it should either divulge information or get any data. So who can control, how do I configure that? I mean, the last thing in the world I want to do is to have to spend half a week typing IPv6 addresses into some application program on my laptop in order to configure my household CPS. So making configuration easy, rational, and correct is going to be a big issue. Scaling up is a big problem. Suppose I have a house with 100 devices in it. That's not an unreasonable thing. What if I move to another house with another 100 devices in it, and now I have to configure 200 devices? I also have to worry about, while I'm in configuration mode, does the 15-year-old next door know that I'm in configuration mode and take over control of my entertainment system? Or do I accidentally configure my neighbor's equipment into my system? How do I prevent that stuff from happening? We have to do something about that. Now, we talk a lot about machine learning and artificial intelligence, and for my money, we mostly invented artificial idiots. I will accept that some of them seem to be getting better and better, but we are a long ways away from the kind of intelligence and let's say, understanding of the natural world that we all gain from personal experience interacting with the real world. We learn about gravity by dropping things. Robots have not yet learned very much about that. And sometimes these smart devices learn the wrong things. There was a chatbot that was exposed to normal discourse on the internet, and it learned a whole lot of bad words, and it learned a lot of other, you know, bad attitudes, and it became very apparent that that's what it had learned, and it had to be shut down. I have a thermostat at home, and it's from Nest. It's a company that is part of the Google complex where I work. And so I put it in, and put it in learning mode, and it learned that I was never home, because one of the controllers was in the dining room, and we almost never use the dining room. We always eat in the little family room. And so for all practical purposes, it thought no one was ever home, and the same is true of the other zone up in the upper floor. And the result is that it thought no one was ever home, and it was so proud of itself for saving energy. It kept the house cold during the winter, and it kept it warm during the summer, and it was sending emails saying, look at all the energy I saved. And I'm sitting here saying, I've been freezing my butt off. So I wasn't happy about what it learned. And I've already talked about configuring and neighbor stuff. There's also this question about ephemeral access, that is to say short-term access to the equipment. Suppose you have a household food gear, all of the members of the household have access to it, and you invite a guest over, and now you want the guest to have access to some of the equipment in the house, but not all of it. So how do you configure the system so it recognizes that guest as opposed to a family member? What happens when the guest leaves? How long does it take you to do the configuration and deconfiguration? We have to think our way through that, and it gets even worse. Suppose that you have a fire alarm system, and the house figures out it's on fire, and it calls the fire department. Now, when the fire department is coming, it would actually be useful for them to have access to temperature sensors and maybe even webcams while they're on the way, so they can see if there's anybody unconscious, where is the fire burning the worst. After the fire is over, you don't want them to have access to that. But under that one condition, that the house is on fire, you want them to have access. And so this business of being able to give access and take it away has to be part of the design in this system. And that takes us back now to the access control question. We've already talked about the guests coming and going, what happens after they leave. And then there's the parents versus the kids. Sometimes there are things that the parents want to do with the household that the kids aren't supposed to do. So now we've got this complex configuration problem. We have to make this easy. And so if you haven't figured out the basic theme here, the basic theme is design, 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 making things easier for people to configure these devices and use them. Otherwise, they won't use them at all. And you could also think a little bit about a manufacturing environment where you don't want everybody who walks in the door to have control over the machines, especially if they're big robots that are assembling parts. So once again, we have a due configuration problem. I've already talked about this long-term issue. Some of you have picture frames at home. Mine have died because their power supplies don't work anymore, and I'm having trouble finding the matching power supply because it was a 10-year-old picture frame. There are a whole series of problems along these lines that the equipment may last for a long time. Nobody may know how to program them anymore, so that's a huge issue. And then finally, I think this is my last slide. I can't overemphasize enough how important it is to achieve these desirable properties in cyberphysical systems. At the top of my list is reliability and ease of use. Even more important than safety in some sense, because if it isn't reliable, people won't use it. They will discard these devices. So reliability and ease of use is at the top of my list. But safety is equally important, because if they're not safe, people won't want them around the house. They won't want to use them at all. So we need to persuade people by demonstration that these devices don't do things that are harmful. Security and privacy are also very important. You don't want the device to fail in such a way that your house is vulnerable or your privacy is exposed. So for example, if the police have access to a webcam after the house has been broken into and has signaled that, you don't want them to have access to the webcam all the time. You just want it under those certain circumstances. You can think up other examples with healthcare monitoring and things like that. In an emergency, you may want the doctors to have access, but not otherwise. So again, that's another configuration problem. Now, there is an autonomy issue here, which is overlooked by many people designing these things, including some of the people that I work with at Google. I tried to remind them that it's important that the house, if you've automated it, not fail to work just because it's not connected to the internet for some reason. You don't want your house to suddenly become inoperable just because the net's down or your access to it has gone away. That means a substantial amount of control and state information has to be local so that the devices can work even if they don't have access to the outside world. And finally, there's an interoperability issue. Lots of companies are building cyber-physical systems. They are all running as fast as they can to the market, and they generally don't care what everybody else is doing. They try to perhaps to be consistent within their own product lines. My worry is for you and me, when we acquire these devices from many different places, and we put them in the house, we don't want 150 different apps on our mobile to turn the lights off and on, depending on which light bulb we bought, or other part of the smart household system. And so getting to standards for interoperability is important. And to your point about translation, I want to push back a bit because translation is risky. Matching semantics is really hard, and sometimes it doesn't work. And if you imagine cascades of translations, it's like the little telephone game where somebody says something and you whisper this to the next person, and by the time it gets all the way around, you don't recognize what was said at the beginning. So let's be really careful about translation and push really hard for common standards for communicating content, for communicating control. There's an organization called schema.org, which is working very hard to allow people to share schema for representations and formalisms, and it's well worth our time to pay attention to that. So I stop there. I think I got the questions that I even had that. So thank you very much for allowing me to take up some of your time, and now it's
Okay, good afternoon. Thank you, Vin. You made a very broad general introduction, so this allows me to be more specific and more technical perspective to talk about cyber-physical systems. So let me try to explain the difference between cyber-physical systems and other types of systems. The idea is that the physical systems out of cyber-physical components, and in the cyber-physical component, you co-design the physical aspects and the cyber aspects. And then you compose, when you compose components, you should have rules of composition of the physical and the cyber aspects. So this is very important to understand, and this raises very, very interesting problems, theoretical problems. So let me skip this and try to explain, to give, so we have plenty of cyber-physical systems. So these will be electromechanical systems that will be intelligent and will be built out of cyber-physical components. Let me tell you what is my dream. I mean, what is a dream, sometimes it's called Industry 4.0, okay? The idea is to extend the principle, the paradigm of 3D printing. So here you see a motorcycle that is 3D printed. So this is by a company controlled by Airbus. So you have a CID tool, you design the motorcycle, and then you send it to an industry, to a foundry, and they produce this, okay? So that's the idea, and let me try to push it a bit more. So you know that, for instance, I would like to design this engine here. I have pistons, we have shaft, very software, where we can specify the geometric model. They produce the 3D model, and then you say, well, this is built from, okay, you give the aluminum or whatever, you give all thermal characteristics of the metal you are using, and then you say we have sensors, and you build a virtual model of the engine, and you are able even to run the engine and measure its performance. Okay, so and then you send the engine, the model, to a foundry, and it produces the final product. And so you can may design here this in Germany, and the foundry may be in China. I don't know. Okay, so that's the idea. And I hope you understand that if you try to reach this vision, you will encounter a lot of technical difficulties. And let me show you this slide that comes from a project I've been on the scientific board of this project. So here the idea was to build a vehicle. Here it's a kind of amphibian tank out of components. So you have cyber physical models of the components, and you have to disintegrate different aspects of the components and build a virtual model of that. You run it, you are happy with that, and once you test it, then you can send it to a foundry and produce this smart object. And the vision is that in the future, cars, aircraft will be cyber-physical objects, and for this we need technology. So the question is what kind of technology we use, and so what is the core of the discipline, if there should be a discipline, a cyber-physical systems discipline? Because of course, when you try to build a cyber-physical system, you will encounter all the problems you find with when you try to design classical systems. But in addition to that, you will have specific problems, and that's what I'm going to talk about. So what can be the core of the CPS discipline? One is to have theory about how to link physical phenomena and computation together, and this raises some technical issues, and then how to engineer the systems. So let me try to explain this. Imagine that I want to design, say, the physical system. I will have to specify first the, say, the physical components. And here I think that computer scientists forget the cyber physical system will have important electromechanical parts. So you need theory about how to combine electromechanical systems with discrete event systems. So should be able to deal with what we call hybrid models. And then you have to discretize these models. And here you care about discretization algorithms, and you need specific models about that. And then you have to generate code, either for implementation or for simulation. So you have these three problems. So let me try to go very quickly through these three problems. So one problem is how to model physical systems. Right? So physical systems, you know, you have theories, physical systems, I mean electromechanical systems, you have components. Components is described by a system of differential equations. You have connectors, you can build networks of physical components, electromechanical systems. So what do the connectors? The connectors restrict the behavior of the components. So these are additional constraints. And one problem, of course, is how to derive this the system of constraints. So here, this is a simple example with an electrical circuit. And this is a list of open problems you can encounter. So for circuits, simple inputs, you know how to do that. But if you want to model complex electromechanical systems, there is no theory to do that. And one problem also is how to combine specifications in a modular manner. This is something we don't know. How, when you connect models to avoid short circuits and things like that, okay, or inconsistencies of any kind. Now, once you have these models, you have to enrich them with events. And then the next step is that you have to derive from the systems of differential equations, you have to derive some kind of data flow model, where here you see from this equation I have this data flow model, where you see here you have physical components, you have mass, you have spring, and here you have mathematical operators. I have integrators and I have this multiplication operator. So these are analog, these are schemes that come from analog computing. Once you do that, this is a step toward discretization. Now, once you do that, then of course, one open question is how you introduce events. Because here, if you have pure differential equations, we don't know how to introduce events. So if you want to introduce events, probably you heard about this model, hybrid automata. Hybrid automata, you have modes, you have states, where here you have differential equations. And when you change mode, you test. So here you have continuous variables, you have guards, you can make change, go from mode B to mode A when this guard is true, and then you can have jumps of the values of continuous variables. You have an assignment here. And the question is how you modify these figures, this data flow model to represent, to take into account discrete events. I don't want to get into details, but the model of hybrid automata exists now since the beginning of the 90s, and still we don't know how to use these models, how to compose these models very well. Now let me jump to another topic, that is discretization. What are the problems that causes the discretization? So in the first step, I have systems of differential equations with discrete events, and now I have to discretize. So discretize, from numerical analysis, you know there are techniques about how to discretize, how to compute solutions of systems of differential equations. So here, just as an example, I'm applying the Euler's method. So if I have this differential equation, I will have here an iterative program that will compute the solution step by step, and H is the step of my problem. So in this continuous data flow model, now the integrator will be replaced by a program that will be the iterative program. And now I will introduce here a clock. This arc is a clock, and the unit delay that will shift the current state, okay, to the next state to do this iteration. So you change the model, you pass from continuous time to discrete time, and this raises some problems I would like to discuss here. So you have this model that is known as data flow model. So data flow models, we have nodes that compute functions. So here we have inputs, you have outputs, and you have this special event here that is a clock. So this act signal marks the beginning of a computation step. These models are used in languages like Lisp or Simulink. You probably know Simulink. And let me now the problem is that if we have hybrid data flow models, we have to enrich this, and this poses extra problems. Okay, now what I can say about discretization. When you have a system of differential equations with constraints, you should have techniques to decide whether these are executable, because perhaps the specifications are not executable. So you need techniques for that. And also, when you choose the integration step, you should care about the quality of your approximation and the safety of the approximation. So these are problems that are still open, and the cyber physical systems community studies. Another problem that appears is what we call xenoness. Probably you've heard about that. So this is a phenomenon that happens quite often in natural phenomena, where you have considered, for instance, you have a sequence of discrete events that converges to a point. Okay? So typically, if you leave a ball from some altitude h, and at each shock it loses some energy. So for instance, here I'm assuming that the speed after the shock is so it loses 20% of its speed at each shock. You understand that the ball will eventually stop. Now the question is there a simulator for this phenomenon? What do you think? Can I find a simulator for this phenomenon?
Sure.
course.
Yeah, of course you can build a simulator for that. You could do an analog version, and you could do a digital.
No, because I mean, you cannot. You will have a discrete step. Okay, so and should become smaller and smaller and smaller. Okay, so it's impossible. I mean, you have to guess. No simulator can simulate this phenomenon. So how it works, engineers have to guess that there is a Zeno behavior, compute by applying induction the Zeno point, and then they help the simulator with a conversion. Okay? But if there are some play with simulator, you see that in this case, either the ball does not stop or it goes through the floor. Okay, it's made up and also. Okay, now let me finish by talking about the third class of problems, that is how we generate from data flow systems, how we generate code, which means that when we program, we have an event-driven model. So programming models are event-driven. And okay, I don't want to give details, but these are very interesting problems. Data flow here, you have data flow connections, functional components, and here you have to translate all of these constraints of the clocks into, okay, taking into account operational semantics of this language into a program, and this is a non-trivial problem I've been studying for a while. Let me mention another problem that is arises when you try how to do this, is the fact that what I say here, mathematically simple, does not mean computationally simple. If, for instance, in these data flow schemes, you have unit delay. So what does a unit delay? A very simple, simplest possible function, mathematical function, takes a signal and delays it by one, as you see here. Okay? And considering Boolean inputs and, of course, Boolean outputs. Now, if you try to give an automaton that implements this, you see that this is practically impossible if time is dense. Why it's practically impossible if time is dense? Because you have to keep track of all the input changes, and the input changes in finite time may be infinite, okay? And this is computationally impossible. So this is a timed automaton that implements this, provided that the input does not change more than one time in one time unit, okay? So you have problems like that, and that's what engineers call synchrony assumption. They assume that the inputs do not change too fast. Finally, I would like to finish with another problem, which is an exciting problem. I've been at least contemplating for a while, which is the following. It's the problem of distributed modular simulation. You know that today simulators of complex systems take the equational specification, so you may have also discrete events here, and they compile them into a set of constraints and then they solve them. And this, if you have very, very complex systems, is not tractable, and they would like to do that in a distributed manner. So to do that in a distributed manner, this means an idea would be the following, that for each component here, I have a program. So for the capacitance here, C, I have the corresponding program, PC, and I have programs, simulation programs, you know the dynamics of the component. And then for each connector, I can replace a connector by a protocol. You think this is a good idea? You see what I'm doing here? So I'm taking a circuit. I replace each component by a simulation program that executes the dynamics of the component. And then, of course, here they interconnect the connectors. What they do, they enforce equality of voltages and equality of currents, okay? I mean, trivial. Now, if I replace this by a protocol here, Leslie, what do you think? This is a good idea to do that?
What are you trying to do?
I'm trying to have distributed simulation. So this is a problem posed by people from industry. They want to have distributed simulation. So they have code, in fact, to simulate an electromechanical system. So they want to simulate Airbus, okay? And they have code for different components. And then they run codes of the components on different computers, and they would like to synchronize them. And the synchronization, of course, will follow the topology of the electromechanical system, okay? Because the connectors show the interaction with the components.
Time is still going to be a problem, isn't it?
Timing is a problem. And in fact, I found a very old paper by Richard Feynman talking about using computers to simulate physical phenomena. And he said, well, I would like that the number of computers I will be using will be linearly dependent on the complexity of the physical systems. And rightly, I think, Feynman doubts about that. And I doubt also about that, that you cannot have this.
But this is only a problem if you want to be like real time, right? Because if you have infinite time, because the simulation does not have to run.
Yes, but the problem is how you have precision here and here. You have protocol that should enforce the these equalities here. With which precision you can do that and which overhead? I mean, think about that.
If the state changes are not clean, for example, and you sample at the wrong time, you'll
yes. Okay, so I'll stop here. Thank you very much. But this is a very interesting problem. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
So, continuous time presentations. So, here we want to just take, actually, after some interaction with the Sifakis, we were playing with one example, which is an effusion pump. So, in a nutshell, it's an infusion pump. Think of it as an insulin pump, for example. It will sense your sugar level and inject the right amount of insulin into your blood, basically. So we think this is a cyber-physical system, and we'll show you why. So in the and also because it's a system that is often used then to exemplify the methods that I use within cyber-physical system. So I will show you what are these types of cyber-physical system and how we, well not we, but actually how we play with the model and some models. And then we will hopefully have enough time to discuss and to ask your question about all the presentation and all what we presented so far, and to discuss the challenges for cyber-physical systems. Okay, so first, why isn't insulin pump or infusion pump different from our usual, for example, lift system? So if we take, for example, the features of a cyber-physical system, well, both systems are reactive, so they do reactive computation, and they have something, the feedback control loop with the physical environment. You push a button, then the lift comes. The infusion pump also, like the sugar level go high, and then you have a reaction to this. They all have concurrency within them, so they're all made of different components. The lift have the button, have the motors, have a lot of components that need to interact and that communicate. The same for the infusion pump. You have sensors, you have control mode, as you will see. You have the control algorithm, you have different components. So both have concurrency, both require real-time computation, and both are safety critical systems. Okay? So the difference mainly is the way we model them. So usually a lift system, we will model the environment of the lift system as a discrete time model. So we will have event that happens discretely. So someone push a button, so you sense this one. Someone entered the lift, and the lift go into the floors, etc. So it's discrete. While the infusion pump, the environment, which is the blood, is continuous. And it's, we will have better reasoning if we represent it as a dynamic model. So I like to think of them both as cyber-physical systems, and the difference is not in nature, but really on the way we represent them and how we represent the environment of each of them. So the and then choosing the right model for doing that is important. And there are a lot of models to do that. So we can focus on the phenomenon and end up doing a system model. We can focus on the architectural model, so how the what are the components and how interact. We can focus on the control model, so how the dynamic of the environment work, and we can also use discrete event also to model them. And the kind of model we use is really dependent on the kind of analysis we want to make. So next slide will represent the, will explain the control models for that.
Thanks. There is still a difference between, sorry for interrupting, yeah. We discussed this this morning, there is still a difference between a leaf and the palm, because in a palm you need a continuous model of this will appear clearly, okay?
Yes.
And this is by the nature of the system. I mean, it's imposed, okay? It's not.
Yes.
It's very different.
Okay.
But this will be explained.
So here, let's go a little bit into the architecture or the design of this infusion pump. So how, what exa- I mean, how is it composed of? Or this is just a simple overview. So this is, for example, a patient who will be connected to this kind of the infusion pump. So we could see here we have different kinds of components like drug data, drug flow, and the patient's data or the clinician, or the clinic person's advisors and so on. And also we'll have his prescription, which is kind of recommendation from the physician. So all these things will be taken by the as the input. And then based on these inputs, so the whole processing or the whole control will take place. So for doing this, what kind of hardware or system things do we need? So for example, here we need some kind of data entry models, which could be used by, built up by using some lookup tables, registers, and so on. And the databases, and also some kind of the bolus buttons, and some kind of different sensors and control units, constants. And at the core of this, we'll have this kind of a control thing that will be running on this kind of some kind of microprocessor or microcontrollers. And also the display so that the patient will come to know what his status or her status is. So how does this kind of, how could we model the whole system in a simplified manner? This is not the exact or accurate one, but it's a simplified manner so that it gives a brief understanding of. So here we'll have different components in this control. For example, we'll have this kind of a reference drug concentration that is prescribed by the physician, or kind of a standard that is set for a person. And also some kind of control algorithms running on this kind of data, and some pharmacokinetic models, which is kind of a, how does this feedback, or the how is the person reacting to the injection of this kind of a drug, or either insulin into his body. And how does the insulin pump actually has to actuate, because it has to respond to this kind of whatever the control algorithms provide the output. And also some kind of a bolus inputs, that is kind of external input that is provided by the patient or by the physician himself. So how could we basically do this all kind of things and kind of provide it as a meaningful model? So we first provide with this kind of pharmacokinetic model, which is kind of drug infusion model. So how does this drug infusion can be modeled actually? So there are different methods or different manners to model this kind of drug infusion. So we take a simple model, which people call it as a one component model. So here we take the body as a single component, and then we model the, how does the body kind of reacts when the drug input is there, and what kind of things it's happening. So they can be modeled using some kind of differential equations based on the concentration of the drug and with what volume he's injecting or she is injecting into his body, and other constants like so on. And then we have the next step, which is the reaction or the control system model itself, like how does the system or the actuation pump or the infusion pump has to respond based on this infused thing. So they can be modeled actually using this spatio-temporal variations, because when we have this kind of inject the insulin or some kind of drug into our body, then the diffuse, then the drug will diffuse into our body at different rates. For example, at the point where we put the insulin, there will be heavy concentration compared to a different spot. So that we have to consider all these kinds of parameters, and then we could model this whole thing. And in a similar manner, they are also modeled using some kind of complex differential equations, which consider different constants, like at what rate the insulin or the drug is injected, and then what is the desired level of drug concentration that he or she can afford, and what is the maximum level that he or she can take in, and different parameters. So, and this kind of spatiotemporal diagram will provide you a brief example considering. So let's assume that this one gives the how does this infusion pump can be controlled or used. Like. So basically, let's have this initial state as the pump is initially off. So once you turn on or start the pump, then what happens is that it kind of pumps in or takes the data, or it has already some kind of data in it, and based on that it provides an initial constant drug infusion is taken place into the human body or into the person. And then it kind of checks what kind, it kind of takes feedback with what kind of reaction the person has in. So it then calculates what is the drug infusion, current drug infusion, and what is the level that is prescribed or targeted for that particular person. And based on that, it will either increase the diffusion or decrease the diffusion based on the thing. And if there is some kind of start bolus, that is some kind of external input, then it again starts to give the input irrespective of considering these calculations. And at the same time, it looks for maximum thing. Like if the person's maximum capacity is some CM, then it has to take care that even though there is a request, the device should not pump in maximum, more than maximum. So it kind of stops the bolus and at the same time stops the pump. So this is a simple model, and how and what tools we could use for doing this kind of things and other things would be provided by Mark.
Okay, and maybe as a side note, so just before this workshop we were having a short chat with Joseph with us, and so then he was saying like a cyber physical system, they also have to think about that you have the cyber, so this software component, and what you want to do is you want to have a model of the physicality inside this cyber. So like with the infusion pump, what you try to have is you try to have a model of the patient, so the one getting the infusion directly inside the software. And what we want to do with these slides a little bit is making you sensible on, okay, this is really a hard task, because the physicality is something that is really complex, and those equations are exactly showing that. Okay, so the last part is again of those automata that I was talking about before already. And so this is just the definition of what the system that I was using, this part system here is doing. And so basically it's an automaton system. And so let's see how we can model this thing. So this is again a narrowing from another perspective. So this is when you use those finite state machines, so how can you narrow the behavior of such a system? And even though this is very simplified, you still see that it's kind of complex, because you have here those stars are system parts that are connecting different simulations there, so different of these automata. And here we have different automata. And we will just have a brief look at this one, which is just the power on self test. So this is what happens when you press the on button. Okay, and so this is modeled then as a finite state machine. And so this is the machine, and you see that there are different checks, and what can happen is it finds out, okay, it should not start, then it goes here, and it returns to, okay, I was not starting. And if it goes through, then it goes here. And on the next slide, we will see that I let again the simulation run, and then we'll see, okay, the tool is just doing a random walk through the non-deterministic automaton, because it can take multiple paths and multiple situations. And what it does, it just randomly chooses which path to go. And what we'll see in the video is that it first chooses to go this path here, so we'll end up here, then it will return here. And in the second, it will continue, so we'll get here, and then the infusion pump simulation will start running. And we'll just have a look at, okay, how this looks. So I press the start button here. So here it says random because it's taking a random edge, and we saw, okay, it was going that way around. Now it's going through. And here we say, we see a time sequence diagram of which states are taken and which transitions are taken. And now we move to the next automaton, which is this one, which is then simulating the next part of this infusion pump. Okay. And here again, I put you the video so you can also watch it afterwards when I send you the slides. Okay.
Okay. Just so to finish our impressions, etc., about playing with this example. So one of the motivation of having such an infusion pump is, for example, if you take a type 1 diabetes, they have to take the drug. They measure the sugar level. They try to calculate the amount of insulin they have to take, and they calculate it, then they see the result, and they have to sometimes overshoot, so they go very low, so they have to take sugar, sometimes they undershoot, and they need to take another sample. So one of the motivation for having such a thing is the system will calculate it automatically and will also take into account the delay. So the delay is part of the model of the individual, and also it needs to be customized to the different individuals. So you have a smart system that will consider the different parameters of the patient and calculate the right amount. So one thing that often makes this difficult, and maybe it's a little bit related to this sampling rate, etc. Since it's a kind of a continuous process, one has also to take the delay into account. So not to inject so it goes very high, which is detrimental of the long run, or it goes very low, and it's kind of the blood sugar goes very low, which is a risk to the patient. So now even like when you have recommendation or guidelines for medical certification agencies, there are kind of guidelines for how much you need to calculate insulin or something, but not how to do it. So you may easily end up overshooting or undershooting. And you can also enter what we call hysteresis. So, and you will have this kind of continuous and zigzag way of sugar. So to give another example with the thermometer. So in my home, which is not that smart, I just kind of, maybe you go freezing, so you go to a thermometer and then you put it at the maximum. And then somebody else goes like, no, it's too hot. So you put it down again, and then it go really low, and then you're freezing again, so you put it. So it's really the same thing, and you try to avoid systems that do the same thing. And also one of the advantages of having all this, doing this modeling, is to be able to provide some guarantees. So and these guarantees also depend on how accurate your environment model is. So without, while keeping it able to kind of process it. And the last thing is about safety cases. So when you have, for example, when you want to use your model to be certified, although there are no kind of a very strict rule on medical devices for certification, you want to build a safety case. So a safety case basically is a structured, sometimes semi-formal, sometimes formal argument to show that your system works. So what happens is you come with a list of action with to prove that your hypothesis is true. And then someone rebuttals each of your assumption. And then it goes on and on until you reach a level where it can't be rebuttal as well. So we want to do that also for this kind of to guarantee safety of these devices. So that's to sum up this one. Now a little bit more kind of a view of the experience. So one of the things here, okay. So one of the things as a software engineer, usually we want to build things. So one of the questions is, when you were playing with hybrid model, etc., it's two things. First is, how easy or difficult is it to build such a model? So basically, we were three. The three of us has a PhD, and we struggled really to even understand the models that of the infusion pump that already existed. So if you are a developer, you want to build an infusion pump, it's really difficult to even build the model and understand them and play with them. So to be applicable, I mean, we need kind of tools and ways to facilitate the development. And also ways to kind of turn, make automatic or easy way to turn them into real software executable thing. And the other thing is, because it's very dependent on the people, we want also to adapt to when we have a reaction that is not that we didn't foresee during the design and the development. We want to be able to adapt to it. So I like maybe resilience rather than reliability, because you're able to become kind of more to adapt to this unforeseen situation and become just kind of more reliable over time. So in a nutshell, that's also a personal vision. So if I want to sum up what's happening or state of the art in the CPS, so we can consider it from different point of view. So from formal methods perspective, we have a kind of a different theoretical backgrounds and on hybrid system, and we want to really to focus on the rigorous modeling and analysis of this cyber-physical system. From software engineering, well, first we want to also be able to elicit and analyze the requirement for example, this medical systems, and also to maybe be able to include in our reasoning some human behavior and have the techniques to assist developer in producing the models, in using them, in simulating them, etc. From a distributed system perspective, we want to be able to turn all these models and components and compose them more easily, to build the execution, the machinery to do that. And also, because we have a lot of background, kind of a lot of existing theory and control theory, a lot of that has been done in electric and mechanical engineering, that maybe we don't already know very, very well, and we need to use. So that's in snapshot what I think the main message for us in the last month. And what I want to finish with is maybe just kind of summarizing the list of themes that maybe we were addressing, and this kind of, as Joseph was saying, the three, the two first of like the theory of, I added resilient cyber-physical system, and also the design and engineering of, so the 2 points. And the third one is really kind of because we want to build, I mean, as engineering, we want to build things, so what's our pillar app, the exemplar that you can use to do things. But that's it, and we can start with.
Okay, cool. So let's see how much time we have left. So we've about 11 minutes for the discussion and then the summary. And I would propose that you two maybe sit now a little bit more to the middle, so that we close the circle a little bit, and then we start.
Okay. That puts us in the target area. I'd like to make a comment about what I've heard so far.
Sure, sure.
One of the things that Joe brought up, I think, is really important, and that has to do with abstraction. It's pretty clear that one way of dealing with complexity is to build abstractions that are adequate to the task. And so I think that's our friend. The other thing, though, that I worry a lot about from the pump example is that not only do you want to look at how it's supposed to work, but you have to ask yourself, what if it doesn't work that way? I mean, what if the drug is more powerful than you expected? What if the sensor is failing what if the sampling rate doesn't allow for hysteresis properly? And so you sample, his blood sugar is low, I jam a bolus in, and then I sample again, and because the delay for effect is longer than my sampling rate, I'm going to pump him full of insulin, he'll go into insulin shock. So there are a set of concerns that we have to incorporate into the design and analysis of these systems that take into account failures of various kinds, and we have to account for that, especially if it's something as life-critical as an insulin pump. So that's just my immediate reaction.
I would like to ask something, sure. Because I'm responsible for choosing, proposing this example. So this is a typical cyber-physical system. It's ridiculously simple, I mean, in lines of code, okay? But we have to very carefully design it, because you have to take into account, have a good model that models the dynamics of the circulation of blood and in the human body, take into account specific parameters. And there are many, many security issues. And I'd like to say that for such medical devices, there is no, you don't have standards yet.
Yes.
Okay?
That's right.
So the FDA says, okay, you can commercialize your pump, but it's at your risk. I mean, if there is a casualty somewhere in a hospital, then it's withdrawn.
You sound like Elon Musk in his self-driving car. Take your hands off the wheel, all bets are off.
Yes, okay, it's like self-driving cars, yes.
Okay, so we should let everybody else jump in here.
Okay, cool, yeah. So you can start thinking about which questions you have. As well, moderating, maybe I take the chance to ask the first question. So, Joseph, we heard a lot about these cyber-physical systems now. So where would you say is the main challenge at the moment? So is it the theory? Is it the software? Is it the hardware? Is it something totally different?
Plenty of things. So designing cyber-physical systems, you need theory to guarantee that they will be performing safely, securely, whatever, okay? And for this, you see, if we don't know how to guarantee safety and security for classical systems, when you try to build cyber-physical systems, all these problems are multiplied by some factor, okay? That's all I can say. So the field is very open to investigation, theoretical investigation. There are many, many problems.
So here's the key thing. I want to distinguish the insulin pump in the hands of a person who controls it compared to one where we turn the software over and let it control the pump. I have a number of friends who are diabetic. They have insulin pumps. The pumps don't decide when and how much. Mm-hmm. They poke the finger, they get blood, they look to see what is their level. They decide when to do that. They know how they feel, right? Or they know I'm about to eat a big meal, or they know I'm going to go out and play tennis. So they have knowledge of the state of the body and what it's about to experience. So they can incorporate that into their decision based on what the blood glucose level says, how much insulin they should put in. If we turn all that over to software, think about all the context that the human being had available that the software might not have. And so every time we build systems like this, we run into exactly this problem of contextual knowledge and personalization for body mass and metabolism and everything else. So this is a scary example. This isn't cyber-physical system. This is scary physical system.
So, Vin, I have a small question. So, since you raised about this let's say that the person is kind of manipulated using, let's say, you treat it, then it's kind of the place where his sugar levels or whatever will change. So, in this context, do you think this kind of self-awareness, embedding the self-awareness on the system, will improve this kind of situations, or what's your take on that point?
So, first of all, if you imagine, if a cyber-physical system has a model of how it is supposed to work, it has a set of sensors, and it has a model, which is something you would, I think, resonate with, of what it should be expecting from the sensors, that's really valuable, because having the system have a contextual model of what it's supposed to do is a very powerful tool for organizing control. Incidentally, when you write software, let me give you an example, email. when you sit down and you're going to write an email program for all these other people, the most valuable thing you can do in the design stage is to think about what tasks are these people going to have to do with your software. When you're writing the software, if it has implicitly in your design this knowledge of what tasks people are trying to do, then you can get the software to take the next state or put or display to you the next obvious thing that you would need because you have knowledge about what the task is. That sort of goes along with the cyber-physical systems too. It's the knowledge that you incorporate into the design. I don't know if you would add to that somehow. Okay.
Okay, cool. Which other questions do we have? That was the perfect chance to ask, because you really have these two guys.
Well, wait a minute. You're making an assumption here, which is probably not correct, certainly not in my case.
You can always do it.
That I have answers, right? These people may have the answers.
Yeah, that's even better. So yes, please.
Yeah, you spoke about software intervening with the hardware parts. Don't you think there is some continuous monitoring required for that software as well?
Continuous monitoring is our friend here. It's absolutely our friend. It's good for two reasons. First of all, if you do continuous monitoring and you have a model of what is normal, which may vary depending on individuals in this example, then you can, once you know what is normal envelope of the measurement, then you can know when you have departed from normal. At Google, we've instrumented all of our data centers from the lowest level, you know, power level, you know, communications, transmission, and so on, all the way up to application level, and we are constantly gathering this data. Why do we do that? Well, we know a system of this scale is always going to break. It's too big to run perfectly. So we know that there's going to be brokenness, and we even know some of the symptoms. So when we send you 404, page not found, through the Chrome browser, we know we did that. Okay, so we keep track of that, and when the level of failure goes above some threshold, which we've established by measurement, that's when we ring the alarm bells and all the engineers run around to find out what went wrong, like we pushed a bad piece of software out that didn't work right. So this continuous monitoring is really helpful for establishing baseline and for detecting variations away from normal,
yes.
Whatever normal.
Provided you know what means normal, and because of the uncertainty, you should update your model of normality.
Yes, yes.
And I think that to do that, learning may be very useful. In
yes.
fact, we have applied learning techniques in adaptive control. We had some parameters, and the parameters, we have only estimates of the parameters, and the system can learn by measuring the parameters and now, the problem with all these monitoring systems is that, of course, you should have a good model, but then keeping this model updated may cost too much. You may have too much overhead, or perhaps you cannot do real-time control, okay? You can make some analysis offline and understand something about your system, but doing a real-time control perhaps sometimes it's not possible. I mean, it depends on the properties you want to maintain, I mean, to preserve. Okay.
So I have a concrete example which I am now allowed to share. I wasn't allowed to share this 2 weeks ago. there's a system, you know that we're doing work at Google on neural networks.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have this TensorFlow system which we made available to everybody. It's an API. And you can exercise some of this neural structure in the cloud. So why do I bring this up? For many years, the way we managed our data centers and keeping them cool is that we had engineers, like some of you, looking at the parameters and on a relatively infrequent basis, controlling the parameters to try to keep the data center cool to the right temperature. We decided, just as an experiment, to have our neural network learn what, you know, the parameters are, measuring the inputs and deciding what values to assign. And so we ran it for weeks, learning what was our objective function was, and then we let the neural network control the cooling system of the data center. This is pretty brave, right, to do that. So we just turned it on,
mm-hmm.
it saved us 40% of the cost of cooling. Not 4%, 40% of the cost of cooling, because the system was responding much more quickly, and it was able to take into account all of the various measurements that were available, whereas the human being has limited bandwidth for doing that. So that's really exciting. That says that these kinds of systems can sometimes have an enormous payoff. And for us, you know, now we're going to do that for all our data centers. Okay. That's just an example.
These are adaptive systems.
It's an adaptive system.
So you had also a question, right? Someone else? Yes.
How do you decide wall problems? I understand that there is a square physical system, and that is not even law, but I would feel myself not very good if I do something that will make somebody die. But for example, that for middle program between two messengers, we have, for example, Skype and Telegram, and in Russia, Skype gives the information that you message to the police, and Telegram doesn't. How to solve the problem that one program has one license process and this other program has no license process?
It's a good example of this problem where they don't quite connect semantically.
Actually, one of the criticism I often have besides translation is also the fact that, you know, the challenges sometimes are not necessarily just technical. So in some cases, technically we can do it, but regarding law or concurrence or something, we can't do it. So usually when we synthesize the mediator, both parties are aware and are willing to allow this one. And also there is kind of a certain, so when we do the translation, we assume certain, so it's something like a subsumption, so one is contained in the other. So the functionality of one is actually more general than the other.
Good luck with that. Usually it's more like this, you know, where they have some things in common and they have a few things in common.
Yes, so actually we only do the translation for what's
for
in
the
common.
and then the rest of it is a miracle, right?
Yes, so one of the things, it's not a miracle, is we don't care about. So we have.
Wait a minute.
But interoperability is something more than for reactive systems. Is something more than syntactic. I mean, much more the types of data you exchange.
Yeah.
Because also the protocols should agree.
Yes.
Okay. It should not introduce deadlocks.
Yes.
So it needs a deeper analysis. Okay. Mm-hmm. Not only matching the types of the data.
Yes, so we do actually we try to match the types if they have certain properties, but okay, so why we do that actually? Because fundamentally, I'm a little bit against the idea of standards.
You're against the idea of standards?
For application levels in a very constrained, so. For example, at the IP level, it makes sense.
Yeah.
But so maybe also at the transport level, etc. But if you go the higher,
it makes sense up at the email level too. Because if we didn't have a common way of referring to people's mailboxes, all those email systems would never interwork with each other. So there are a series of reasons why commonality can be very helpful and important. It doesn't mean that all the systems work exactly the same way, but it means they may have common semantics and syntax that will allow interoperability.
Yes, but the thing is, it's also you need time to reach this convergence into a standard. You need enough maturity to do it. So now, for example, while you're waiting for a standard for the smart bulb, what do we do? So we can have this mediation that will do the translation, even if it's not perfect, it will wait for the standard. And how about other applications? So, I don't know, dating application, how do I make my Tinder talk to the other, or whatever. So So when we have this kind of a lot of applications that are new, and I don't want to have 500 on my iPhone.
You don't want 500 apps on your mobile, that's right.
Yes, so how do we do something that's still not perfect, but good enough?
So the idea is that you dynamically synthesize something that, but this is, even computationally, this is not tractable, in my opinion. I mean, because synthesis is not tractable, but this is becoming too technical.
This is like the n² over 2 translation problem, if you're not careful, right?
So this is like a little bit a more different thing, but what you could think of also, because Amel was naming this IP, maybe you know about this hourglass model. And then you have some standard in the middle and then it deviates again. So Wint was talking about email, which will be upper and left. So you have the pros and cons, you probably thought about that. So we would have time for one more question if there's one. Yes, please.
So you were saying a lot that with cyber physical systems you have to be careful because when they fail, they may do great damage. So isn't it as important as moving forwards technology-wise, moving also forwards in an ethics and legal-wise, because that could really, really, is already slowing down the development of those devices, because companies, they just don't want to take the responsibility that comes with the cyber-physical system. The self-driving car is a perfect example. Mm-hmm. Some cars just like my car has a tempomat, and every time it starts raining, it just turns it off, and it's like, ding, the road's wet, please drive yourself.
So first of all, I agree with this concern about ethics and also with regard to quality of work. I got into a lot of trouble when I said, while I was still president of ACM, that we should seriously look at certification or licensing for certain kinds of programming tasks. And I guarantee you most programmers don't want you to have anything to say about their code. I'm a programmer, I know how to do this, you don't have anything to say about it. But in physical engineering, at least in the United States, you have to have an engineer's civil engineering license to be responsible for building a bridge or a building or a freeway or something else, because it's assumed that you've been trained. I think we're going to get to the point with cyber-physical systems where software certification will be needed for certain kinds of applications, and you pick two of them.
I mean, it's already there. I was working for an automotive supplier, and you already have like certified.
And so it's not there in the U.S. right now. Okay. We have a bunch of companies that are building devices, including ours, that don't involve certification or anything else. At some point, this chicken is going to come home to roost.
There's a difference. Like, the software is certified. It's not the person that does the
software. Well, good luck with certifying the software. Especially the cases where you have to worry about all of the potential hazards because you didn't take something into account, like the dynamics.
But I think that you should certify the product. Certification authorities care about the product. Certify an aircraft, a pump, or a car, okay, globally. The question is, there are here responsibilities and political issues. I think governments and organizations could be much stricter. When you buy some software, you have no guarantees about, say, security, nothing.
It says this software is not certified.
I think that, most systems are very poorly engineered, and this will be a huge problem if we are seeking in the future strong integration of systems. That's obvious to me.
Right.
We'll be hitting a wall.
And so I also like your point very much, because an important message that I always tell people that are working in this software or engineering thing is, like, during the war, engineers were building bombs, and they were saying, okay, I'm just building the technology, and then in the end it got a bomb. So you always have to be aware that technology can be used in a certain way, and you have to be responsible in developing the things that you do. And so
that's the ethical component.
Yeah,
you
ethical
should
component,
really
yeah,
feel that responsibility.
Yeah, this is why we're really at the point. So unluckily, the time is over and the others are already coming in. So, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Also, both will be around, I think, the entire week, right?
Yes,
so
I'm here.
So you can always approach them. So I have one more slide, two more slides. So please wrap up. So this is what we went through. At the beginning, you were filling out that you didn't have much clue about cyber-physical systems. So we hope that we brought a little light into the area that you know a little bit more about it right now. Thank you for participating.
Something as simple and innocuous as this becomes a challenge for all of us to maintain accountability control of our critical infrastructure systems. This actually contains the Stuxnet virus. It's impacting industrial control. If you get up in the morning and turn off your alarm and make coffee,
power plants, power grids,
and pump gas,
transportation, telecommunication,
and use the ATM, you've touched industrial control systems. It's what powers our lives.